Bibles to Ephesians chapter number 3. Sorry, Ephesians chapter number 2. Ephesians chapter number 2. And if you need a Bible, someone will give one to you. You shoot your hand in the air. I am going to be reading this morning from the Message translation, so it may sound a little bit different. But certainly following along, you'll certainly receive and get the gist of what our reading text is saying to us today. Ephesians chapter number 2, verse number 13 is where we will start. When you have it, say, I got it. I think they may have it up on the screen shortly here. But let us jump here into this text here. Now, as I stated, we're starting this new series called Be the Church, and it's going to give us an opportunity to think more deeply about the relational fabric that is necessary for us to really be the church, and the many ways that we are being called to resist all of the kinds of divisions that are often being imposed upon us by our larger culture and our larger world. And many of us know that sometimes as we are attempting to resist some of these factors, how many of you know that these factors also directly impact our own families and our own relationships, our interpersonal interactions, on your job, in your neighborhoods, in your homes? So make no mistake about it, what we need to do to be the church must happen more than just us coming here on a Sunday morning. Amen. Touch your neighbor. Amen. Somebody. Amen. Tell them it's going to take more than Sunday. Amen. It's going to take more than Sunday to be the church. So as we think and pray and preach through this series, I hope that we understand even today as we celebrate communion, as we celebrate the Eucharist, the Lord's Supper, we are, hopefully, will be reminded of the powerful way in which Christ brings us together across all of these divisions and barriers and compels us to really be the body of Christ, aka the church. Verse number 13, Ephesians chapter number 2, scripture says, now because of Christ, dying that death, shedding that blood, you who were once out of it altogether are in on everything. The Messiah has made things up between us so that we're now together on this, both non-Jewish outsiders and Jewish insiders. So let's just pause right there just to give you a quick sense. Amen. There was a moment in time where the whole of the early church was thought to only be for those Jews, those of Jewish heritage, to actually be included in the unique work that Christ did on the cross. And Paul, who is thought to have given the grounding for much of the thinking and writing that has informed the book of Ephesians, has been very clear that if Jesus died for the whole world, then it's more than just Jewish folk that get to be blessed by this great sacrifice. So it is indeed a blessing, amen. Maybe some of y'all a little slow this morning, amen. But just be mindful, amen, that, you know, except for, you know, y'all that are Jewish in here, this is good news, amen. Because we would not be included in this great work. So Jesus tore down the wall that was used to keep one another at a distance. He repealed a law code that had become so clogged with fine print and footnotes that it hindered more than it helped. Then Jesus started over. Ooh, that'll preach all by itself. Amen. Some of y'all need a good start over. Amen. Instead of continuing with two groups of people separated by centuries of animosity and suspicion, Jesus created a new kind of human being. A fresh start for everybody. Christ brought us together. Your verse may say reconciled us through his death on the cross. The cross got us to embrace, and that was the end of the hostility. Isn't that a great paradise, that the cross, a tool for death. God is always able to take those things that others mean to destroy and divide us, and God can inhabit that thing and cause us to come together. Amen? We'll keep reading. Christ came and preached peace to you outsiders and peace to us insiders. He treated us as equals and so made us equals. Through him, we both share the same spirit and have equal access to the Father. That's plain enough, isn't it? You're no longer wandering exiles. This kingdom of faith is now your home country. You're no longer strangers or outsiders. You belong here. With as much right to the name Christian as anyone, God is building a home. He's using us all, irrespective of how we got here, in what he is building. He used the apostles and prophets for the foundation. Now he's using you, fitting you in brick by brick, stone by stone, with Christ Jesus as the cornerstone that holds all the parts together. We see it taking shape day after day, a holy temple built by God, all of us built into it, a temple in which God is quite at home. It's the word of God for us, the people of God. Let us say thanks be to God. So we're going to speak, amen, on this series, Be the Church. Today's first sermon title will be Strangers No More. No more strangers. We are no more strangers. Bow your heads with me as we pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, bless the word of God that has been read for us, the people of God. We ask you to hide this word in our hearts so we will not sin against you. Please send your anointing that makes preaching and teaching easy. Let it rest upon me and even the hearers of this word. In Jesus' name we pray that the people of God say amen. 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 Look at your neighbor. Tell them you're no longer a stranger. You're no longer a stranger. Now, understand, my brothers and sisters, that part of the project of modernity, of our contemporary philosophical, political, and sadly even within our religious spaces, is to carve us up into these categories and into these descriptions that always remind us of our difference. And it is not to say that difference does not exist. Amen. Because at the beginning, God was in God's creative modality space. Amen. You talk about a creative. How many know God was the most creative creative that ever lived? Amen. So God's not hating on creativity. Amen. God's not hating on us having distinctions, or else we'd all be clones. We'd all look like one another. We'd all dress like one another. We'd all everything in the world would look the same. A tree would look like, a house. I don't know, you know. I mean, you know, like distinctiveness, right? Lions would look like elephants, and you know, the night would look like the day. I mean, there is at the root of who God is. God is always embracing difference. And this must be an important kind of orientation for us, or else we will begin to think that there is something inherently wrong with us being different than one another. Amen. God is not looking for you and I to become clones of one another. But God is looking for you and I, as the scripture says, to honor that in him we are fearfully and wonderfully made. Now, in a world that is always trying to politicize our difference, in a world that is always trying to commodify our difference, in a world that's always trying to make sure that we are retreating and going back to our individual corners, God is always meeting at the middle of the room and inviting us all to come out of our corners and meet God there. Now, on a macro level, that sounds like magnanimous and too fanciful and and aspirational maybe to grasp, but let's just boil it down to our own circles of relationships and influence. How many of you can acknowledge that there are some places in your own house, your own family, your own neighborhood, where people are dividing ourselves up because of difference? Amen. You get some differences going on, and it's like, you know, I'm through. You know, I know you're my sister and everything. I know you're my parents. I know you're my husband, my wife, but I'm through. Hello, somebody. Yes. Yes. Anybody ever been through? At least you said you was through. I'm done. This is it. I had all I can take, and I'm not taking it no more. Amen. And it is not to say that we don't have a moment, a breaking point, amen, where, you know, we do need to kind of, you know, love folk from a distance. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about, you know, the petty things, the things that at the end of the day don't really matter. See, part of what we are called to do and be as followers of Jesus, as folk who are being, as the scripture just said, built into the church, is to appreciate that we all will have some differences along the way. And if we are going to be the church well in the world, then we must make sure that we are not just boiling our church performance or experience or reality into a two-hour window of the week. I mean, we did spend a lot of time and energy remodeling this space so we can have a wonderful, wonderful place to meet every week, and we can make it a flex space to do all kinds of wonderful ministry. But how many of you know, still 90% of the church we will be will not be at 1305 University Avenue. At the very least, we gather here to get refueled, to get refocused, to be challenged, so when we do leave this building, we can truly be the church. Now, understand that you may not be at church every day, but it doesn't free you from being church every day. Hello, somebody. You may not be here every day in the church, and I thank God for that. But it don't free you from being the church every single day. And the church is nothing but the called out people of God who are proclaiming the good news that this world has been afflicted and crippled by sin, rebellion against God, rebellion against God's creation, rebellion against one another. And God has called out a people who, if no one else is willing to do it, will remind ourselves and the world that God had a different way of life. And God is, through the church, reconciling the world unto God's self. What do you think about that for a second? That God, in all of God's omniscience and omnipotence, all of his knowledge and power, God said, the way that I'm going to make the world in right relationship with me is I'm going to use y'all. Mm-hmm. Yeah, some of y'all are really understanding the magnitude of that. It is kind of funny. For some of us, it's kind of scary too. Hello, somebody. Because how many of us know that if you catch me on the wrong day or the wrong moment in the day, reconciliation is the last thing that's on my mind. Okay. I wish I had some honest people. So it speaks to the greatness of who we are, who you are, that God is choosing to reconcile the whole world. Think about that. God is choosing to reconcile all the folk in your world, in your space, in your family, in your community, your school. God is choosing to reconcile all those folk who are far away, who are strangers, who are aliens, who are foreigners, who are the others.
Amen.
God is saying, I'm going to reconcile all those folk using you. Woo. Lord, that ought to make us all just stop what we're doing, get on our knees and start praying. God, help me. Help me. That we are the pathway to reconciliation for God. I got a slide up there. Next slide, it says, this is just one description. This is not a total description. So all you folk who, you know, understand what being the church is supposed to look like, this is just a partial description. And for 6 weeks, we're going to be unpacking many descriptions of what it means to be the church. But I like this as a starting point because it helps describe some of the work that we must do. Be the church means that we must, according to some, protect the environment, care for the poor, forgive often, reject racism, fight for the powerless, share earthly and spiritual resources, embrace diversity, love God, and enjoy this life. And understand that some of this is grounded in some of the social teachings of many church traditions throughout history. The Pope will be here in a few weeks, and while we were there at the Vatican, we heard him say something very powerful. He said that how can we say we love God but can't love what God created? Amen. This is a deeply theological and ontological statement. Why? Because again, many of the early church theologians and thought leaders, they understood that God was and is the source of all that is being. So out of God, everything literally proceeds. Think about this for a second. Out of God, everything proceeds. Nothing is existing unless it existed from God. Creation proceeds from God. Salvation proceeds from God. Even you and me, with all our craziness, proceed from God. And one of the early church fathers even said that you can tell one's salvation or spiritual growth and formation by their proximity to the one whom they proceeded from. God, and if that brother or to God. Now understand, this ministry of reconciliation is critically important because I am a McBride. I will always be a McBride. But sometimes, even in my relationships with other McBrides, it may get a little tense and estranged. It doesn't change that I'm a McBride, but sometimes it will require a neutral party to come and help repair the damage. So I can be in right relationship with that who I already am.
Yes.
Lord, help me today. And I believe God is trying to tell the church, you and I, that in this world, there is a lot of estrangement going on, division, separation. But part of our job of being the church,
come on, Pastor,
is to embrace this ministry of closing that gap.
That's a word.
Closing that gap. Why? So all of us can benefit from what we're going to do later on. This communion table, this place and space where God reminds us always,
amen,
that I paid the ultimate price to reconcile you to me.
Amen.
So how do you do this every single day? Give me a high five and tell them every single day, every single day, every single day. So the first thing that I want to lift up that is necessary if we are going to remove the proximity gap, the distance, the stranger, foreigner distinction, we must always start with common ground. This is going to help somebody. Just think of all the many ways in which people are estranged or strangers in your life. I believe that if we're going to be the church, we must first start with common ground. Everybody say common ground. So what relationships are you in a relationship with other folks that require you and I to start with common ground, that which we agree on? I don't know if you've ever been around somebody who can't ever find nothing to agree about. Isn't it nice outside? Yeah, but you see that cloud? You see that cloud? Are you sure it looks nice except for that thread that's hanging off of the back of your shirt? I want to go eat some food. I want to fast. I want to eat some food. You know, people just can't ever seem to agree. How many know that you're not going to be in the church if you are the ultimate disagreeable person?
Well,
in your church. Just trying to tell you. Some of y'all, I mean, this is why you don't have no friends. Just keep it real. Some of us, nobody likes me. I'm so lonely. It's just such a, I got a cross to carry. I'll tell you why. Everybody say common ground. Common ground. There are always things we could disagree about. And it don't mean we should not push disagreements. But if disagree is your only way of being, you in trouble. You in trouble. Can you imagine if God just kind of took that posture with us? Every single chance God has to interact with us, God starts with the uncommon factor. I'm God. I mean, you stop right there. I'm God. He's like, dang. How do I overcome that one? Common ground. You, in your marriage, in your family, with your children, on your job, you have to be skilled in the art of finding common ground.
Yes.
Or you will not be able to reconcile anyone or anything. And we do this justice work. treated us as equals. Through Christ, we both, Jews and non-Jews, can share. That is quite some common ground we each have. Christ. And if this is the ministry that Christ has lived and modeled, I want you to plug your unique gifts, skills, and position in the world in some of these works that Christ did. How in your family can you help make things up? How can you help tear down the walls of racism and xenophobia and all these, you know, I was so compelled by this young, I was gonna put the figure up there, but I know we had a kids in, so I decided not to. But this young boy, child who washed up on the shores, I don't know if y'all saw that. Refugee crises happening all over the world because of war, man-made problems. Folk in jails and prisons can't come home because, as we call them, Pharaoh Jerry Brown won't do what's within his power. We call, some call the president the deporter-in-chief. 2 million immigrants being deported. All of these actions that push back against what we are called to do. Hello, somebody. We must be people who are able to find common ground in our shared humanity. Some of us need to figure out, how do I help find common ground and push the reset button and start some things over? Because how do you know some things you can't just keep trying to move with that as the background? Hello, somebody. Something you just gotta start over. I'ma just start over. Get my big eraser out or get me a whole new piece of paper. Start over. Because the laundry list of offenses are too long. This is what we must be about if we're going to build this common ground. And I am so convinced that what we'll do later, communion, Eucharist, it is the greatest expression of common ground that the church is constantly reminded of. We do communion every month, not because we are just, you know, looking for, you know, a little snack before we go have the big meal. Not because we're so religious, but how many know practices create memory? I can bring Moses up here, some of y'all other, like, you know, athletes. And the more you do a practice over and over again, it creates what we call muscle memory. You look at all these athletes who are able to move in split seconds while the rest of us, you know, we can't even catch remote control before we hit the floor. To make me brand new, whole. I like that. Heal, redeem, Christ gives us the opportunity to become like him. That is the greatest common ground. Jesus, this table we will take together, it reminds us that all of us needed Jesus. We needed what he did on the cross. We needed what he do for us every day. We need what he's going to do for us tomorrow. We need him to forgive our sins. We need him to help us. We need him to save us. We need him to deliver us out of the messes we get in. We need him to deliver us out of those traps that the enemy set for us. Give your neighbor a high five and tell him, common ground, common ground, common ground. The second thing that you and I must be mindful of is we must, listen, learn how to see one another differently. If we're going to be the church, we must learn how to see each other differently. Now, one of the scriptures that I pull out of here, verse 19, it says, you are no longer foreigners or strangers, but citizens with God's people and members of his household. Ooh. What new eyes do you and I need to put on so we don't see one another the same? See one another the way the world tries to tell us to see one another. If I were to ask you to describe how the world sees us, many of us would start with our gender, our race, our sexuality, our national origin, our money, economic position, our religion. We would start with all of these things. But how many of you know when God sees us, God is able to look beyond? I mean, think of the biblical example when Samuel is looking for a king. Sent by God, this is the man of God, the man of God. It's a prophet going to look for a king on a divine assignment, walks up and he is picking everyone except for the one God wants. And Samuel's in there like dumbfounded. I can't figure it out. I mean, this tall, strapping young man is not the king. This warrior is not the king. This handsome looking person is not. All of these distinctions. Samuel is caught looking through the wrong eyes. And God teaches Samuel a lesson, and it's a lesson for all of us. Man looks on the outward, but God looks at the heart. God is able to look beyond our physical characteristics and look at something much more eternal and constitute our makeup, how you made up. That word. Huh? We gotta learn to see each other differently. This is so important in the church. I'm becoming less and less worried about the kind of choices people make. Because I believe no one should be defined by the worst thing they've done in their life. Amen. Folk in jail for stuff that we didn't get caught doing. I know some of y'all, you know, just slid out your mama, you know, speaking in tongues and walking on water, healing the sick, raising the dead. I know none of y'all never cheated on anything in your life. Never broke any laws, never puff passed, never got something in exchange for your puff pass. I know. I know that's no one in here. But there are some brothers and sisters who did get caught. And they're no worse of a human being because they got caught for something we didn't get caught doing. They even call it a jacket. Ain't that something? Now, who make up these words? You call it a jacket. Like, they'll put something on you and have that thing following you your whole life. You can't even get a job because you stole a Twinkie. What does stealing a Twinkie got to do with me having a job? interesting how God is able to see that person beyond their worst mistake. This is what being in church has to be about. If we can't see others the way, listen, God sees us. What's the point of you following Jesus? Now, it don't happen overnight, because there's some folk I can forgive easier. Especially the folk that don't do me no wrong. Oh, I forgive you. You messed them up. I don't know. Just pray for them. But then you mess me over. It's like the grudge, you know. The grudge is real. Like, you stay away from me. Don't be fooling me today. Amen. Bust your head to the white meat. Amen. Just a quote I heard. Amen. I'm not the one today, right? But what does it mean for you and I to ask God, give me your eyes so I can see what I'm doing? Paul says it like this. He says, do not regard or see one another from a human point of view. Because if anyone is in Christ, they are a new creation. Some of us need to ask God, help me to see the new creation in my brother and my sister. Help me to see it before they even see it. Help me to see that you are doing something in their life. I know they're full of rage and anger and hurt and pain, but help me be able to see that you are doing something new. And help me be a part of the new mix that is emerging. Hello, somebody. This is what we are called to do. And then finally, the last thing we're called to do, I believe, if we're going to be the church, if we're going to no longer be strangers, we have to create space for God to dwell. Yeah. You should be the ultimate God dweller. Verse number 22, become a dwelling place. Woo! Where God's Spirit can live. Now, I just need to let you know that there are some ways of living, y'all hold on here now, that are a repellent to the Spirit of God. Now, you can't keep God out of where God's supposed to be. Man, you ain't that strong, so don't, you know. But, you know, repellent, it's like, you know, how many of you, you know, you ever been somewhere and it just stink? And it's like, you walk in and then your whole body, you know, starts to shift. Your feet keep moving, you like, that's a repellent, amen. It ain't gonna keep you out, but it's starting to do something to you, like, man. I don't know where this stuff comes from. Well, sometimes your life can be like that. Parts of your life, God is trying to like live and move and dwell and hang out with you. And God is, he's there, and then all of a sudden you're like, Man, that's horrible. God ain't going nowhere. God is just kind of like, that's not what I created you to be. We all should be wanting to get rid of the repellents in our lives. We should be sitting around here like, you know, God is going to take me how I am. Well, you be careful. This is how I know we don't really believe in God. As much as we say we do. Anyway, you know, my dad is and was a real dad. I mean, real. Like, he was there. He was not a figment of my imagination. And I felt him through the loving embraces and through the corrective gestures. And I believe that my dad would respond certain ways if I did certain things. And that belief kept me from doing certain things some of the time. Like, you can control what God's gonna do. God gonna take me the way I am. What? Where did you get that from? God don't have to do anything. Remember, the ultimate difference is God is God. God can do whatever God wants. God can take it today. God can say, not today, McBride, and I'm out of luck. We don't control God. Amen. That's a good thing for all of us who feel like we ain't never, you know, in no crosshairs with God. That's a bad thing for others that we like to exclude. So part of what I'm trying to lift up is, if God wants to dwell with you and I, how do we make our lives, as much as it is within our power, conducive to where God wants to be? God says, I want to live in praise. So how do you make sure your life is a life of praise? God says, I want to live in holiness. So how do you make sure your life is a life of holiness? God wants to live in right relationship with you and other people. How do you make sure you are living in right relationship with other people? God, I think God don't like to be around stanky attitudes and mean folk and cussing, lying, stealing, thieving, robbing, assaulting. I think so. You know, so how do you make sure that you try to lose the repellents? Lose those things that make God, like, you know, I want God to be happy to show up. Amen. And dwell in me and my situation. Not have God like, oh man, Michael's calling on me and I know I got to go because I said I would, but I don't want God showing up into my situation all disgusted to be there. What does it mean for you and I to be places where God dwells? What would it look like this week if God dwelled in every environment you were going to be in? On the day of Pentecost, the greatest expression of God's Spirit dwelling among the people says, when they were all together with one accord and one mind, suddenly. I don't know about you, but I'm looking for one of those suddenly moments. God, I need you to suddenly come into my situation. Suddenly make this thing right. We were up in the Capitol and Jerry Brown's people told us that it was going to take an act of God for him to sign this justice bill that we were looking for to end racial profiling. Can you believe that? You tell people of faith it's going to take an act of God? That sounds like Nebuchadnezzar or Belteshazzar. Not them folk who just kind of forget, I know you the governor. But that's still quite a way down the totem pole from God. So he said, we're going to give you your act of God. And we stood out there and we prayed and jumped and hollered and screamed. So much so that even the police had a retreat into the governor's office. I was up there again. I felt like the Spirit was dwelling. I believe that. In your family, your relationships, on your school campus, get on the right side. Find out where is God dwelling. Because if God is dwelling there, every enemy got to flee. Hello, somebody. Stand with me. Let's